Namaste everyone. Today we are going to talk about an important concept in mathematics known as infinite series. The basic structure of an infinite series is of this form: a plus a square, a plus ar square, plus ar cube. This addition going up till infinity. And in this sort of addition, what most students are unable to understand is how an infinite series gives us a finite result. So today we'll talk about how this is possible through various methods. Firstly, I would just like to give the students a brief intuitive understanding of how this is possible through general life. Let us say that we have two sticks. I have two sticks with me. Two wooden sticks. Right. And I have to give these wooden sticks to a person named, say, A. But I do not want to give them in the normal form. So what I do is that I give the first stick to A. Right. Now I am a bit of a miser sort of person. So I will not give this complete stick to A. I will cut it into half and give the half part to it. After that, even for the remaining half part, I will cut it again in half and give that to A. In this way, I will keep cutting these parts. Half, 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 half. And it will take me eternity to give the complete stick to A. Right. Now let us examine this physical problem in a mathematical form. In the mathematical form, we'll say that A keeps getting sticks. How is A getting sticks? In this format. First he gets one stick. Then he gets half of a stick. After that he gets half square of a stick. This is the way in which A keeps getting sticks. And even though he gets sticks an infinity number of times, we know that he never gets complete two sticks. Or in other words, at time infinity, he gets two sticks. So intuitively we can understand that summation of this series should be 2. Because this series is nothing but giving sticks to A in a half sort of way. Right. So this might give you a intuitive understanding into the nature of infinity series and why its summation comes out to be a finite number. So today we will discuss about a few innovative methods of doing the same summation rather than the standard methods. So let me first tell you a story. So the story goes like this. There is a road, right? And two famous athletes are having a race. This is athlete number one. Not too good at diagrams, so I guess this should be sufficient. And this is athlete number two. So athlete number two is quite young, so what we do is that we give him a head start of 1 meter, let us say. Or if you want to generalize it, let us say it should be A meters. Okay. So we give athlete number 2 a head start, and because athlete number 2 is young, so athlete number 1, let us suppose athlete number 1 has a speed of S. Athlete number 2 is younger and his speed is slower. So let us suppose athlete number 2's speed is S into R, where R is a real number between 0 and 1. Right. We all know that after some point of time, athlete number 1 is going to overtake athlete number 2. This is quite clear. But let us analyze this issue a bit more in detail. So, in some time what happens is that the athlete number 2 reaches the position of athlete number 1. That means, athlete number 2 reaches here. Right. Or I guess I said it in the opposing manner. Athlete number 1 reaches here. Athlete number 2 goes a bit ahead. So, in reaching to this point, athlete number 1 travels a distance of A meters. in the meanwhile, athlete number 2 will travel a distance of A into R meters, because the speed of athlete number 2 is Rth fraction of athlete number 1, right? So athlete number 2 reaches this point, right? After this, athlete number 1 again reaches this point after some time. But in the meanwhile, athlete number 2 is slightly ahead of it. And this is the famous Zeno's paradox, in which Zeno tries to say that athlete number 2 will always be ahead of athlete number 1. So it is a paradox, because this is against a common sense that athlete number 1 will never be able to overtake athlete number 2. But let us forget about the paradox for now, and let's just concentrate on our problem. Athlete number 1 travels this AR distance the second time. In the meantime, athlete number 2 travels AR into R, that is AR square. Distance of AR square, it's a bit complicated here, I'll write it here. AR square, right. So when athlete number 1 travels AR, athlete number 2 travels AR square. And this is how they keep going. So initially, let us calculate the distance of athlete number 1 mathematically. First, he travels A. In the next step, he travels a distance of AR. So the total distance traveled by athlete number 1 is A plus AR till now. After this, he travels a distance of AR square. Right. In the meantime, athlete number 2 will travel AR cube. Again, athlete number 1 will travel AR cube. In this manner, he will keep going until AR raised to infinity, when he meets athlete number 2. Right. So the actual distance travelled by athlete number 1 is the summation of this series. However, we have another simpler method of calculating the distance travelled by athlete number 1, and that method does not involve any series summation. It is just a simple algebraic method that many simple physics students might be expert in. So let us try to calculate the distance travelled by athlete number 1 in reaching athlete number 2 through normal physics. The speed of athlete number 1 is s, the speed of athlete number 2 is sr. Athlete number 1, let us say, travels d distance to reach athlete number 2. Let us say the point is at which both athletes converge is this. So this is d, and athlete number 2 travels d minus a. Now we know that as the ratio between the speeds is r, so ratio between distances will also be r. So d minus a by d is equal to r. Right? So by calculating the result of this, we get d minus a equal to dr by just taking d on the other side. And solving this equation simply, we get d into 1 minus r will be equal to a. So d will be equal to a by 1 minus r. Where d is the distance travelled by athlete number 1, which is same as our series summation that we have found out here. Right. So according to this, we get to know this series summation directly as a upon 1 minus r. There is no other involvement. We do not have to involve the series summation in this. Okay, this was one of the methods, one of the innovative methods of solving the series summation. Till now we have discussed about innovative methods of solving infinite series, but now we'll come to the standard method that most people use of solving these series. So the standard method is in this format. We have a series, right? Let this series be, let this summation be called S. So we say that S is equal to A plus AR square plus AR cube up till infinity. One thing that we observe is that, let us suppose you take a common in this thing, right? And then in the remaining series, you take r common for this part. We observe that we will get 1 plus r square for the rest of the series. So this is actually equal to our original series, right? So this original series can be written as, let us denote it by P. We can write it as P equal to 1 plus R into P. This approximation can be done because being an infinity series, the infinity term in both these things will be, both these series will be same, right? So doing this approximation, we simply get P as 1 by 1 minus R, and substituting P here, we'll get S as A by 1 minus R. A simple straightforward method of solving the series, but a bit boring. Apart from this, people use other methods also, which are basically the same, but they appear different. For example, one method is multiplying R to S to give us this new series, and subtracting these two series to give us only A, because all terms get cancelled and the infinitieth term does not make a difference as R is less than 1. So S gives us A by 1 minus R. Both these methods are fundamentally the same, but they just appear different